given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of ZTalk Radio, its affiliates, or sponsors.
Well, hello there. Welcome once again to Looking Into the Unknown here on ZTalk Radio. Thanks again for chiming in on this April 24th, 2014. This is Lee Allen, a.k.a. Crazy Legs.
And this is Patrick DeHart, a.k.a. This is Jim Wilson, a.k.a. Magic Hands.
Good evening, everybody. This is Jersey P, Patty Allen.
Psst. Hey, one of these mics is going again, man.
It's, well, just touch the back of one.
I think
it's the cord.
It's yours.
It's this one. Always.
You're keeping it out.
I think when I turn it.
Hey, am I sounding any worse?
Yes. Just say yes. You sound pretty good there.
No, I don't. I should just
sound
like this.
Shabby. Well, if you're just tuning in, we want to thank you so much for coming on to the show. Our special guest tonight is Neil Parks from Chillicothe, Ohio. Parks Paranormal. And we want to have, he'll be calling in about 7:30 Eastern Time. So in about 21 minutes, Neil will be calling. I want to get to a few things before we get started, before Neil calls. If you're having troubles, first of all, listening to us, hit refresh on your computer. And voila, Patty is in there. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask her. And she'll make sure we try to get them answered for you. Real quick, got with Lionsgate Films, and tonight I'm going to be giving away some shirts. The shirts are for the new show that's coming out tomorrow night, The Quiet Ones. I think tonight they may have a debut after midnight, but tomorrow it actually is in theaters all across.
So please, do not call in tonight for your shirt, because I would love one.
So here at 7:35, okay, I'm going to be asking a question. And then I'm going to be giving you the call-in number. And if you get the question right, you will get a shirt. And now how we're going to do that is that you have to be in our chat room. And you'll have to private message Patty so I can get your billing address. Because let me tell you.
The billing address?
I'm not your billing. I'm sorry, your mailing. Yes, because you're getting charged for these. No, just kidding. These are free. And I need your mailing address so I can get your shirt to you. So see, I'm getting my shirt to you. Not like others sitting here say they're going to get you a shirt and they still haven't got one.
Are you serious right now?
But real quick, let me look at one of these things.
Oh man, don't! I don't even want to look, man. I don't want to
look. Check that out. The quiet.
Oh my God, dude! Nobody, please do not call in.
And
please.
Look at the Quiet Ones.
I'll take one
it
of those.
It airs tomorrow. It's pretty cool. It's a black T-shirt, people, for paranormal lovers. This is the show you want to watch. This is about a poltergeist, a true story. And you definitely want to be calling in when I say to get one of these shirts. I have a couple extra larges, I have a couple mediums, and I have a large. So,
how about tub size?
Nope, just extra larges is all they sent me.
All right, man. Leaves me out.
So that will be going on tonight as we're talking to Neil. So this is an exciting night. You know, just to be getting the emails from their companies to help promote their shows. And they're going to get with me on any paranormal thing from now on. So
that's
I posted
cool.
it on our website at paravisions.com, the image. So that is the image on the front of the shirt, okay? And then on the back it says The Quiet Ones. It's pretty cool. And so we look forward to doing some of those with Lionsgate Films.
How did they get a hold of you? They Google paranormal.
No.
Did they see our team name somewhere?
Yeah.
Were we in one of their shows?
It must have been somebody that had our name from a network.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Well, that word travels fast.
Yes, it does. Good words.
Good words.
Another thing, Jersey P here got us into paranormal societies. That's awesome. I put a banner on our website. You click it. It's on the front page under Jersey. Our banner. You click it. It goes to their website, and it's across the world. International. It is a group of, like, if you, wherever you are, you can click it, and you could go to the state and find out who's in your area to help you and for a paranormal investigation. So, yeah, we're involved in that. That's pretty cool. Wanted to share that out there. Man, I'm excited for this summer because we got some really cool things coming up. We're going to be investigating the Bell Nursing Home.
Naked.
No, not this guy. You can.
I will.
We're going to be going up to Canton, Ohio. You guys have to check that out on Facebook. It's Discover Stock Con. It's coming out. It'll be October 17th, the weekend of October 17th. The lady just got with me the other day. She wanted to make a brochure, and she wants a paranormal activity picture. So I gave her one in a quickness, and I gave her one of our FLIR thermal shots that Patrick had took over at a residential local. And you could see the little girl, so that's going to be the background. So that's pretty cool.
That's awesome.
And so I was talking to Glenn today, one of our buddies in the crypt, and he's getting this all together. And some cool stuff, guys, while you guys are sitting here, I'm sharing with everyone. He's talking to a guy here soon. I got to shoot him some dates for July because our June is just not working well because he's got a lot going on with baseball, and he's going on vacation with his family, and we're going to be out of town. With Savannah. So this June is not going to work, but July will. And we're going to be going up and investigating some locations, and then we're going to be sharing them at the at the event in October. So the reveal will be with the Historical Society, and the Chamber of Commerce will be there.
Cool.
So the Chamber of Commerce and Historical Society are putting this on, so it's that's pretty cool.
You said that's October 17th?
Yeah,
October 17th. And what's the fest called again?
Discover Stock.
Discover Stock.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And also, one of the places that we're going to probably get where we've been told right now no, but I think Glenn's going to try to make it happen. The guy that he's talking to is buying the place. It's the OTB Hospital up there in Canton. And because the guy wants to convert it into apartments. And he's afraid that... told Glenn already he's afraid of the asbestos, and I'm like, well, good Lord, people, we grew up with asbestos. If you were born in the 70s and the 60s, you grew up in asbestos. You grew up with lead paint on your baby cribs. You gnawed on it. We're still here. We made it. We survived. And, you know, and I told Glenn a little bit, he's going to do this. He's going to go up there. He doesn't want to do paranormal investigations there. He'd like to do tours through it to build some money up. And I told him to do tours. Let us investigate it. Show that. Let people go through it. Do tours. And so, fingers crossed, let's hope that that happens. But we do have a couple places that we're going to be investigating up there that looks pretty cool. So, guys, if you're in the Ohio area in October, close to Halloween, come up. Say hey. Who knows? We may have some shirts then. I don't know. Something may happen by then.
So more time, what's the name of the event? StartCon?
Discover Stock.
Discover Stock.
Discover Con.
Stark.
Oh, Discover
we're all
Con.
Jacked up,
okay.
Man. We are
Thanks
all jacked up.
Discover
Patty, won't you
Con
tell?
Stark.
Let Wait, Jersey be in. Let Jersey, let her talk. Let her tell the story.
I plugged it into the chat room. It's facebook.com, DiscoverCon, Stark.
Stark.
S-T-A-R-K.
I gotta lay off those bean burritos.
And the Stark is because it's in Stark County, Ohio. Absolutely.
Thanks, Jersey.
Cool.
You know, you could see your wife over there, just like the anger's building. Like, these jackasses. They don't even know what kind of event they're getting ready to be in.
No. I just get I would be frustrated if I were a listener being told incorrect names.
That's all. And it causes confusion, you know?
I don't like to spread lies.
No. And next thing you know, these lies, these rumors that get spreaded, resort in a bad convention. We all know how that goes.
It always comes back to bite you in the ass.
That's right. Rock and roll! Lovies. So you got anything to add to that, Lee? Sorry for the technical difficulties. Alright. Rock and roll! We are back live here on Seatalk Radio, and we are ready to rock and roll!
How about country, though?
Yeah, why is it always gotta be rock and roll, man? Let's do something else. Let's do some, like...
This is a no banjo zone.
Easy listening, man. This is easy rock. Yeah, just
Easter Sunday. Speaking of Easter, did everybody have a good Easter?
I was with Dave,
my buddy Dave.
So yeah, it's okay.
Good Easter. Jim,
good Easter.
Did you win any money?
I went down to the Rising Star. Ate at the buffet. Pretty damn good buffet. Like any, casino, they always have good buffets. Played a little bit of the quarter slots.
Do any good?
Sure. I walked away $5 less.
Well, that's not too bad.
That's a success story.
Yeah.
Like I always said, if you walk in and you still walk out with some money,
yes,
you won.
You didn't give it all to the man.
Oh, no. I did have a feeling, though, at the roulette wheel, so I did me $5 right down the 20, and it hit that damn 32, jumped in 20 and right into 32.
You won a 20?
I won a 20. It only would have been 175 and leave the nickels, though.
Well, who cares?
Exactly.
That's money.
Exactly. For $5?
So did somebody that really needed the money win, or did some dude...
Oh, no, the house won.
Oh, okay.
They don't really need the money, you know?
No, they really
Unlike
don't.
Unlike anything, a lot of these casinos are popping up, so...
Everywhere.
Yeah.
And we're getting a lot here in Ohio.
It's just coming down, the ones that were always populated are just going to go sparse and thin, so...
Well, the thing is, here in Ohio, we don't have tables. Right. We only got slots, because we don't... It's law that we're not allowed to have that shit.
Mark my word.
By summer, in the summer, I see it happening.
If it wasn't in the wording that they couldn't have them, it will happen that they will have them.
Well, I go in and do a lot of things. There's two casinos that I've been in here, Dayton and Cincinnati, Miami Valley Gaming, there's one in Dayton.
Yep.
Hollywood Casino, the Dayton, Miami Valley, and Monroe. And the one, the horseshoe down in Cincinnati, they all have the wiring that they put in the ground, okay?
Yep.
For the tables. So when they need to, those come out in big puzzles. Yep. So they can pull the wire up, connect the tables.
It's preemptive. It's preemptive.
Yeah.
It was already in the plans. Come on, when you build a house, you already have an idea of where you want your junction boxes to go. And there's always got to be room for more room. At least you got to have the forethought. When we put the pool in on our backyard, we had the idea they wanted to run electric for everything. Well, we never used it, but we had it. So. Well, yeah, it's only a matter of years. Come on, like the story I've said, the boat that I worked on, what the whole span was, it will always be on the river. It will never be open 24 hours. It will always yada, yada, yada. It's a new boat. It's parked. It's 24/7. Market, a couple of years, you'll have table games to play at. But again, like I said, you have so many of them now. All your casinos have thinned out, so they've got to come up with new ways and new gadgets to keep you there.
Yep.
A lot of them got like boogie nights, or they got dance halls. Your area, the Miami, has a racino. They got some horse track sets that adds, some excitement. Some of them have bought more land and put golf courses. So you've almost got to make it a resort.
Yeah.
Maybe a one-stop shop type of thing.
So people can hang out a little bit and do other things.
You got the golf, you got the food, you got the dinner, the dancing.
We have some amazing things around Miami Valley,
yes.
I mean, you can go in, throw some quarters in the slot, do some racing,
yep.
cross the street, jump the fence, check out some inmates.
I was just going to say that.
Yes, because people, they built this by a prison.
But think about it. The horseshoe's the same.
Yeah.
They look out the back window of the prison, and they're looking at the casino.
So is
that like almost a psychological thing?
That's a tease.
Damn, I shouldn't have done wrong.
Because I can be over there winning some money.
But when I break out, I can still jump over there.
They won't see me in this stripe.
Or it could be what got him into prison.
Yeah.
And they're like, oh, dang. Memories.
True. That is true. You know, I want to jump to a subject that Jim had mentioned earlier. And it doesn't happen just in schools. It happens in adult life. And that is bullying. You know, you hear a lot about that. Jim knows a friend of his is... Her daughter is going through bullying at school, and it's everywhere. You know, it's not just in school. It's not in junior high and high school. It's at your workplace. It happens all the time.
You know what, though? In talking with her about this, though, it's almost like the definition of bullying has changed. When we were kids, bullying would be just like the movie. I can't think of it right off my head, but stealing somebody's lunch money every stinking day so I can't eat. That was bullying. Today, it's just simply like playing tag too hard or pushing someone to the ground. My God, you want a lawsuit when that happens.
Sure.
People grow up.
Yeah,
get a set and freaking grow up.
You know,
this is ridiculous.
I was talking to our friend Glenn about a little bit of bullying and about how kids these days, if you raised your kids the way we were raised back in the 70s and 80s, we wouldn't have these damn wimps. Because we got a lot of wusses that don't know how to fight for themselves. They got to stand behind a laptop or an iPad or a cell phone. They can't make eye contact with people anymore. They can't make a conversation. The schools have took out Jesus Christ. They're changing up the Pledge of Allegiance. You know, you can't stand in front of your school as a soldier in your soldier's uniform without getting in trouble. I mean, what else is there, you know?
Yeah, that's, you know, to add to that, because you started mentioning a lot of technology, that's the stuff we did not have when we were growing up. And the technology right now is what's helping fuel this bullying in a whole nother way so it doesn't end. It just continues from school. So the kid goes home, or adult, or whoever, and now stuff spread all over the internet for the entire world to see. This now leads to now death. You know, the kids aren't handling it like they used to. They used to go home depressed, cry to mom and dad about it. Now they're just taking their lives. Kids didn't used to, growing up, we didn't kill ourselves over being bullied, you know. But of course, you know, we didn't have this tech stuff, you know. So the tech is really hurting because these, like I said, these kids are going home, and it just doesn't leave.
Well,
whereas us, we had the option to go home, you know, play video games, call it a night, where they get online and they see, oh, Sally's a slut and slept with so-and-so, and now that's going to haunt them, for, you know, the rest of the night.
Whether it was true or not, again, hiding behind the computer.
Well, and let me add to this. Glenn was telling me up where he lives in Canton, Ohio, that at the high school, the football coach, which took him to a lot of championships, he actually got fired. And the reason behind the being fired is because they do not want him to teach their children the old school way. Isn't that sad? You know, so the old school's gone, man. We can't say old school anymore. If you do, you're going to get fired.
Teachers can't discipline.
So you just got to be a wuss and just deal with it.
I got to find that picture because it was an emergency post.
Yeah, I mean, it's sad.
And the parents can't scold them either because then that becomes abuse. And they get to go to jail.
Sure. Well, you know, I mean, even in school, you
my
know,
blood pressure's going up,
with the technology when they're at lunch or, you know, they get a break, or hell, when they're even in their class, they're texting each other, not the paper, they don't know how to write anymore. Kids don't know how to write. Have you seen some of the kids' writing? It looks like first grade writing, because they don't know how to write.
No, that's, I'm still lost at why we're taking, some of the writing out of school right now, the cursive. I'm blown away by that.
Well, you know,
it looks so much more professional.
You know, you still need to do a signature.
Right. Well, what's going to happen with that? I mean, you can't. They will not be able to do a signature.
I think what the future is holding out is you do not go to retail stores anymore. That's going to be a way. You do not go down to the DMV to renew your license. That's going to be a way. Because checks will be old school.
Okay.
Writing a check will be history. Everything will be involved with the internet.
Right, right.
So all of your information, your routing number, your checking number, your credit card numbers will all be on here.
Right. And then there's also, Lee, there's also the chip, you know. There's still talk of the chip, you know.
Yeah.
Which, that's a whole nother story itself right there. But the chip, you know, I mean, it's supposed to be able to do everything. You just take your hand and...
Well, that's in the Bible. You know, they said that the world will be ending with plastic things. You know, it's all there. And
right.
It's working. That's why this... You know, my aunt passed away. We had her funeral Wednesday. And, you know, the pastor, you know, that was doing that. It's their pastor where they go to church, at a Presbyterian church. And, you know... Resurrection, he's coming back, and it's getting close, because this world, this old world, is about done, and he's got to come back, and he's got to shake it, because, I mean, the way things are going, you know, and I hope everybody that's listening to me right now has God in your life every day of your life, every day.
Speaking of your aunt, the other day I had something really weird happen. And I was over at my friend's house, and I kept hearing in my head, you know, a song. And it just kept playing over and over until I started singing the song. And eventually that whole night, it got to the point where I was like, well, I need to go.
Hey, hey.
Hey. Hey, hold on one second.
Hey.
Sorry to interrupt you.
No, you're fine.
But
way to go,
Neil. I didn't get to the end.
Hey!
Hey. Well, wait. Where I was going with this was the song. I decided to post a video of me watching the sunset along with the song playing. And your sister asked me, can I share this? Because this was my Aunt Shirley's favorite song. Oh, wow, buddy.
Yeah, I did see your... video, but I didn't know you videoed that. That was at the pond?
Yeah, I videoed that.
Wow.
Yeah. Good job.
I got skill, son.
Good job. It's not just Jim Wilson and this team that can video and take pictures.
Oh, you got my blood, boy.
His voice will be coming back for this.
Oh, God.
Hey, who is on here? Who? Tell me, what's your name? Who just called?
This is Rasputin, calling from the grave.
Very nice. So
yes,
welcome to the U.S. today.
They have my mummified penis in a jar at a museum in Russia.
Sweet. Only this gay.
How much do they pay to see that?
Two pecs.
Two pecs.
Oh, that's a hard bargain.
I know. Most people stand fully erect for that one.
Oh, man. Neil, you are bad. Ladies and gentlemen. Neil Parks,
the
just
man,
entered the building.
The myth, the legend, the paranormal author, the paranormal investigator, the Star Wars action hero, Neil Parks.
There were a lot of people wondering if I'm going to be in the next Star Wars films because of that image.
Sweet.
Yeah, Jim worked 5 hours on that image.
He couldn't shrink your head.
It's really hard to do that. Like right now, I'm videotaping this, and my head is so big right now. I'm so close to the webcam at this point.
Well, Jim was saying that when he put you up against Darth Vader, your head was bigger than him, so it was like...
Didn't
you say something about it was
negative.
Like a...
I said this man was so appreciative of what I did for him, I went and redid it just for you.
Yeah, you know... That's what we do. Jim loves taking this. You know, he'll ask a little bit what you're about, you know, and he puts this together, and that's Jim's magic. That's why he's Magic Hands.
And on part why it took 5 hours, of course, because I was using my dial-up computer, so it was taking a while to get to them sites.
I thought you were joking about dial-up.
Yeah, didn't we just mention technology, Jim?
Yeah.
Jim, he's still old school, man.
I got a good computer. I just don't have the Wi-Fi.
Yeah, you need to get the Wi-Fi.
I got the hookup.
You still listen to the fax and whistle and chime sounds when you're connecting?
Yes.
Yeah, it takes me back to 1998.
Yeah, and he used to go out on the telephone tower and adjust it a little bit.
I still use the dial and it does it automatic.
Oh, the old antenna ears?
Yes.
He's got the aluminum foil attached to the freaking...
And he's got some on his head.
Yeah. Don't give away my secrets. Sorry, buddy.
Like the image from the movie Signs, that's Jim. On getting on the internet. We need another glass of water.
Swing away, Jim. Swing away. So he's Magic Hands and you're Crazy Legs. Is that because he has Magic Hands?
Yes, he does.
You want to watch him work him, Neil?
Yeah, I do. And is there a YouTube channel showing that?
He's actually pretty good with the flute. it's the saxophone. I'm sorry. Jim played the saxophone. I mean, that's what he did back in the day. Huey Lewis's band didn't have nothing on him, man.
Huey Lewis.
And also, another group that didn't have it on him is
Chicago.
The Boss.
And no, I'm thinking of, yeah, the Boss. The big man, the Boss. No, my
Kansas.
Mind is just blank.
Journey. Europe.
The Soul Man. What's the group that sings Soul Man? Ooh. The two boys, the brothers.
Blues come on,
brothers.
Jersey Pete, come on.
Blues Brothers.
Get on in this, Jersey.
Oh, boy. So, Neil, how are you doing, my friend?
Oh, I just had an awesome dinner. I was surprised that I actually got to wolf it down before I did the show, but the preschool showcase that my daughter did tonight where she sang and played the bells. The preschool is at our church, which is really convenient since I'm the tech coordinator for the church. I design all the pyrotechnics for that. So we got back in time to have dinner. Now I'm calling in and doing the show with you guys, which is always an honor. Very sorry about your aunt dying. I know how losing loved ones feels. And
yeah, it
currently, I have a lot of projects going on. I'm in talks right now with, I don't know if I should be saying this out loud, but I'm going to. I'm just not going to elaborate on what the project is, but it's with Pilgrim Productions, the production company that does Ghost Hunters, Dirtiest Jobs, and I think it's American Pickers, isn't it? They do that too?
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, they do that. But they're pitching a show right now that will take place in an undisclosed location for now. And I would be one of the head investigators to head that up and lead the way if I'm, in fact, selected after they interviewed me. And I'm also dealing with a production company out of New York for a show that they just pitched yesterday to the History Channel.
Oh, nice. Well, good luck,
very
buddy.
Very nice. Yeah. You deserve everything coming your way.
Including the pie in the face?
Yes, and a swift kick to the ass.
So that's why I got an email from a lady that you referred her to me.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Let's do talk about that.
Yes. How did that go?
Well, we haven't investigated yet because we've been busy, but I did talk to her, and I will be getting with her in May, and she seems pretty terrified. You know, and her last email was, do not forget about me. And no, we will not forget. So, yeah, that's where it was. You know, we try to help everybody. That's my motto, is to help everybody any way I can. So, you know, thanks for referring her to us. And we will take care of it.
Over the past year or so, I've had to refer a lot of cases to you and had them your way, because
yeah.
I'm busy with being an assistant soccer coach, working as an animal rescue individual with a vets clinic here in town, also with my church work and traveling, book signings, writing.
Signing autographs.
And eating.
Busy.
Signing brassieres.
I got something you can sign, Neil.
What would that be?
Let's just say it's a full moon tonight.
Would you like it in binary code?
Let's start the game, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Neil, here's what we're going to do. Lionsgate Films got with me, and I'm giving away t-shirts tonight on the show.
Oh, yeah.
Guess what movie?
The Quiet Ones.
Absolutely. And
for sure.
Now what we're going to do is when I'm ready, I'm going to air the call number to call in, and we're going to give them easy questions, and that pertains to the paranormal.
Mm-hmm.
And if they get it right, they'll go into the chat room and private message Patty so we can get their address so I can send it to them. And we're going to start now. And the phone number to call in, the first number person to call in at 513-318-7272. It's 513-318-PARA. So let's see who calls in first.
PARA.
And we'll give them a shirt.
Para.
Is this gonna crash the server? No.
Only if you're on dial up.
No, it will be fine. So let's see what happens.
Yeah, we've heard that before. So please, people, once again, do not call in tonight. I would love to have one of these shirts for myself. So if nobody calls in, I'm having a great night. Oh, damn.
Hold on 1 second.
Hang up.
Hello, welcome to Looking Into the Unknown.
What's up?
Hello, what's up? Who's speaking?
This is your boy, Chris, from Tag Team Paranormal Society.
Oh, Chris. Chris, how's it going, buddy?
Fat King Tone.
What's up, Neil? Fucking Scooby there?
What's up, brother?
Ow! And our special guest tonight, Neil Parks. I don't know if you know him, Chris. But Neil's our guest, and I'm going to start, Chris. I want to give you a question, okay? And if you get it right, you will get a shirt, okay? Okay. Now, last night, April 23rd, at 6:57 p.m., Patrick, a.k.a. Scooter, had this for dessert. Go. I'm just kidding.
Oh, my God. I was like, you're good, man. You're good. Because I was about to shit all over myself for a minute. I was like, this guy, you're the real deal, man.
The real deal.
I will take Patrick's excrement for 200.
Oh, my God. Okay. Let's go with a tech question.
A tech question.
Yeah.
Oh, why do you put me on the spot here? Okay, a tech question.
Nothing hard.
Okay.
Nothing hard.
Okay, Chris. A melmeter. What is the basic reading for a melmeter or any EMF detector?
Depends on the environment.
That's the right answer. You win! Oh my God!
I was gonna say, what if I was standing by electrical box?
No, it really, that can be the correct, answer. Now, there's several different things for that. One of the most common is, 0.1 to 1.0. I've heard several different, and that's a topic we've had on the show before. There's so many different things for average readings that it's hard for any investigator to get the truth.
That's right. That's why when we walk onto a scene, what is the first thing that a team leader or a lead investigator will send one of the investigators to do.
Right. Do a EMF reading, a sweep throughout the whole place.
Do an EMF sweep. Yep, do a baseline sweep.
All right. All right. Chris, you are the first one to receive the Quiet Ones t-shirt.
Along with a scooter shirt.
Let me tell you something. These babies are hot. Nobody has these yet. And they're sitting right here by me. And I just showed the team hot. And I'm going to be sending you one. So if you just share in a private message in the chat room for Patty to get your address, and we'll ship it out, buddy.
All right. Scooter just doesn't count as my Paravision.
Oh, God. Tell him, buddy. Tell him.
Power, we're sending you a Paravisions one. Okay. See, I thought the last time it was a scooter one. So you don't want the scooter one then.
See.
Oh, you have a scooter one? Absolutely. Does it say small stepping on it?
Oh, my friend.
Oh!
You know, something about this guy, this caller right now, he is unbelievable. Hey. A couple of weeks ago, I posted something from Ghost Adventures, and who was it? It's Aaron from Ghost Adventures. That's his motto is big stepping. And
oh,
I have a picture with him, which, you know, I thought was pretty cool. This guy is a little hacker. He jumps in real quick, he photoshops it and it says small stepping within seconds. Unbelievable, man. Unbelievable. You're unbelievable.
Patrick, aka Scooter, small stepping.
This is what awesome looks like, buddy. This is what awesome looks like.
Oh, my God. Well, Chris, thanks again for calling in. You are the winner. Ding, 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 ding,
ding, ding, ding, ding, ding, ding, ding.
And I will be...
Yay.
Hey, and this is Lee. I will be shipping those shirts out.
Tomorrow.
He said shirts. Did you hear that? Plural. Shirts. I'm talking in general for everybody, all of our winners.
Now, Chris, do us a favor. Please do not spread the word on Facebook that you just received a shirt from our show, because I would love to have one of these shirts tonight.
Okay.
Chris.
I'll do my best not to share the ever living out of it.
Chris, have a great night, buddy.
You too, guys.
Uh-huh. All right, Neil.
Yeah.
Our first one. Next question, Neil, you will get to ask, okay? We'll do it about 8 o'clock.
I'll have
another call in around 8. And these babies are hot, son.
Nobody
has this shirt yet.
I seriously want to rip off my shirt right now and put one of those bad boys on. I might stretch it a little bit, but who cares?
Now watch out, Zach Bagan. These guns are going straight in.
You know, I got pulled over the other night, right?
You did.
You know what they found? Two guns in a 6-pack and a 12-pack.
Oh, I thought they found...
I have multiple packs.
I thought they found a party, a keg. So, Neil, one of the questions I wanted to ask, you've been really quiet lately on Facebook. You've been doing some... coming up with some other ideas for some books?
Yeah, I've been working heavily on finishing one about Beaufort, North Carolina, which is an area that's over 300 years old. It was an original settlement from early colonies. And one of the stopping areas for Blackbeard the Pirate, in fact, he has two houses that still stand to this day that he once owned. And there's been a lot of bloodshed in that house, not only during that time, but during the time of the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, the outbreak of Spanish flu, various other illnesses that have been brought over from, because it was a fisherman's village, Beaufort was at one time, it was a fishing community. So I've been brushing up on that book, trying to finish it. Also working on a full-fledged novel, my first full-fledged novel, not just a compilation of short stories, but working on an actual 20-something chapter novel. Good news is Haunted Holidays, my third book, actually got nominated for a literary award this year. So I've been promoting that. Plus, I've been nominated for eight different categories for the Paranormal Awards that are being held in, I believe, New Hampshire.
Yep.
In June. I've been nominated in eight different categories, so I'm not sure if that means it was a pity nomination, or I'm really breaking ground here and people are noticing, or people are...
Yes, we're going with that, yes. Jim said we're going with
that. The Mothman Festival was a huge success when I did my presentation there.
How was that, buddy?
It went so well. I had a huge turnout, and people, from the time I set up my booth, people were lining up to speak with me, buy books, order shirts, decals, and then after I did the presentation, which they always have me speak on Sundays, and my term of endearment nickname is Preach, because I incorporate a lot of scripture and biblical basics within the research I do and how I present it, and scripture fact-finding, and then, of course, tying a lot of geography into what I do and showing what point in history and where in the world this happened first and how it ties into what's going on in our current timeline. I just get into a lot of that, and people, I guess, like it. So they then bombard my booth after the presentation and buy what I had left, including the shoes I was wearing.
Wow, dude. You know what? Now, let me tell you about shoes, okay? Patty and I went to my cousin's church, and he was preaching, and we dressed up pretty nice. You know, we had our high-dollar shoes on.
High-dollar.
You know what? We came home, Dale. We came home, no shoes, okay? And he's like a sales guy out there at the pew. You know what I'm saying? Let me tell you, when he was standing at that altar, he just, you know, he was looking for shoes for this charity, and... You know what? I think God answered everybody, and he was by everybody in the church. Everybody gave their shoes. So we're walking outside to our car in the snow, barefoot. But you know what? It was for a good cause, and the good Lord was right there, and he pushed Patty and I both to, we both looked at each other at the same time and went, let's do it, you know, and we did. And, you know, till this day, you know, sometimes when we get dressed up and we're like, man, you know what? I'd sure like to have that, because I like to have my boots, or I like to have my shoes, you know, but it's good. It's a good thing. And, you know, if you've got it and then it's between you and the good Lord, you guys can work it out. It's going to happen.
And Neil, do you do the Mothman event every year then? How many years have you been doing it?
This was my fourth time. I do it every couple of years. That way I don't oversaturate it, because new people start building up in the audience every year. More people catch wind of the festival. It's in its 11th year, and it's a huge event for that region.
Right. And what kills me is there's only like one hotel that's close by.
Yeah. We ended up having to stay at the Hampton in Gallipolis, Ohio, which is over the river. So that's where we ended up staying. And then we ate at Buffalo Wild Wings, and my cohort and I, which was my brother-in-law, he's a part of my team, and he came with me that weekend. We were both so hungry, because we were going to go into the burger joint where they serve the Mothman burgers.
Awesome. Oh, yeah. Awesome. And the Mothman sauce they put on there, I don't know what that is, the secret sauce, but it's dynamite.
Mothman semen. But anyway, we were going to go in and... and have the Mothman burger, but I don't know, maybe I'm a snob or something, but the minute I walked in, I'm like, there's no way this restaurant passed health code, because I didn't see an A or a B on the window stating what the cleanliness factor was. I'm like, I'm not putting this food in my mouth. So we went to Buffalo Wild Wings for dinner. We skipped lunch, didn't have any snacks or anything, and we were so wicked hungry, we ate too much hot stuff right away. And all the way back to the hotel, felt like we were going to puke, you know? It was horrible. So after about 20, 30 minutes of lying around going, like that, and munching on Tums and drinking milk, we were fine. But what was really awesome was the next morning, before we went back to the festival, I don't know if you saw the picture that I had posted a while back with me and the Abraham Lincoln lookalike. Did you have the pleasure of seeing that?
I think I have seen it, yeah.
But I ran into him in the during the continental breakfast Hampton always serves. He was getting bacon next to me. I'm like, oh my God, it's Abe. My favorite president, of course, because we haven't had a good one since him anyway. But I was happy to have a picture taken with him, and he was playing it up. He was doing the part. He's like, what contraption is that, young man? You know, I was doing a selfie with him. He was playing it up.
He was still in character.
Yeah, I was impressed.
That's awesome.
And you know, I told him to watch his back when he goes to the theater later.
You know, every year the festival takes place, we're always going. We're always saying, "Yeah, let's go to it." And then there's always another event or something that gets in the way. Last year, of course, it was Phenomenology in Gettysburg. Mm-hmm. You know, we were in Gettysburg last year. Year before, same thing. And then this year, some other things, but. We'd love to go to the Mothman
Festival.
Now,
Neil, I tell you what, you've been going there for a while at the Mothman event, and let me tell you, even though, you know, I was the same way when I walked into that little hamburger joint, because I saw two ladies that looked like they became from the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yeah, chopping up beef, and, like, you want a hamburger?
And I saw you could see the stove. They're using a regular kitchen stove out of a home.
Yeah.
And you saw, like, big, did you see the big old bag of potatoes and all stuff sitting there? That's country cooking, man.
And, you know, the thing that kills me, Neil, is the fact that they're still stuck back in the 50s or 40s, you know? It's like nothing in that town since the disaster took place has changed. And a gym will tell you, I'll never forget, I was like, do they have I was getting ready to pay with the ATM. You know, I had a credit card. I was getting ready to use it, and I look at a Jim, and he says, "No, there's no ATM machine here that you can use to get cash." You know, and I'm like, "What?" And the lady's sitting there telling me, "No, we cannot take a credit card. We have nothing to use with it.
I remember
you have to walk about a mile down the street, and you should be able to find one if the store's open." I'm like, "Oh, great." So, yeah, it's just so weird how they're so stuck back in time.
Mm-hmm. They seem to welcome visitors and tourists, which is nice, because usually when you've got that closeness of a kinship factor within a small rural area, they're very skeptical of visitors, but they seem to be very welcoming of anyone who comes into that area.
Festival, they must have set up like one of those portable ATM machines. You know, they have like a Fifth Third.
Oh, they should do that.
Something like that.
Where do they put the event on, Neil? Where's that put on at?
Oh, it's the entire historical downtown district from the Carlisle Hotel all the way to the Mothman statue, and then the whole backdrop down to the where it drops down to the river, and it has all the bleachers. That whole area is open, that whole venue. They have a stage set up for bands to come and perform. And I've got a gal pal of mine out of Dublin. She's the one who is the hellaciously awesome hula hoop artist, where she actually hula hoops with Flaming Hula Hoop. Yeah, have you seen that chick on YouTube?
No.
Yeah, well, I hooked up with her a couple of years ago because we were both a part of Good Day Columbus on Fox 28 News out of Columbus. We were both guests on that show, and we started touching base after that, and I hooked her up with a gig. This year, she'll be performing at the Mothman Festival, and she is this sensational, I guess you could call her a hula hoopist, if that's the proper term, and she actually sets the hula hoop on fire and does this crazy performance art with it. She's amazing.
Neil, do you know what would be better? If she dressed up in a Mothman outfit and did that. Now that would be the shiz.
Or if Neil would participate with her.
Right, do like a double tag team, like they get in between the hula hoop.
He's Mothman.
Yeah.
And he's coming after her.
Right.
Yeah, and she's trying to ward me off with the flaming hula hoop.
She's like, back away.
Yeah, she'd have to wear a coconut bra. Just to make it effective. You know, I have to act like I'm savage and I want to take her.
Yeah, you should actually wear a Chewbacca outfit.
That would be even better. Cool. Chewbacca with wings and glowing red eyes.
Yes.
Well, now that is a different story. Now, we, you know,
Moth Baka.
Star Wars, if somebody's listening, they're like, oh, that's a good point. Take notes, everybody. Take notes. Tonight's show, please take notes.
J.J. Abrams is listening in right now.
He is coming back.
So have you actually went searching for the Mothman while you've been there?
Yeah, I've gone to the areas where he has appeared or claimed to have appeared during accidents, incidences, or some sort of horrific event. I've been to the area where the bridge used to sit, and the columns are still there. They're still standing upright. They left them that way, and have a nice big plaque with the names of the dead on it. I've never seen a creature anywhere close to what the Mothman was described as being. And I mean, if you look at it from a biblical standpoint, it sounds very much like a seraphim angel, which, if you're familiar with the breaking of the seal in the Book of Revelations, or the breaking the seals, releasing the plagues, they are described as these beast-like angels that have several different appendages or things coming off of them, like a lion's head and the body of a man and seven arms, or one looks like an insect with the legs of a man and the arms of a gorilla or something, just crazy like that, almost like when Paul was dreaming this, he was on LSD or something. But the way it was translated, I mean, how else do you describe those things if you've never seen them before? So I guess you got to be patient with the author, right?
Yeah. Now, did you keep up with him? Do you keep up with Mothman, like the sightings? Do you believe in that?
Absolutely.
Like the recent sightings?
I mean,
do you think that's just all baloney?
In the end times, there will always be signs and wonders. Now, what source is providing the signs and wonders is anyone's guess. Is it godly, or is it of a demonic manifestation to divert our attention from godly things and to take us further away from what the primary goal and the end game is?
Right, that's true. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point.
That's why I tell people not to mess with Ouija boards. That's why I tell people not to take part in seances. That's why I tell people to not drink the blood of a virgin or an infant. That's a whole other story.
Right.
Never had a discussion about drinking blood, no.
Now, go ahead, Jersey Pete. Take it away.
Oh.
But don't you agree, Neil, that as an investigator, the equipment we use is basically similar to a Ouija board? We're asking for communication and hopefully getting it.
Hopefully getting it from the right source. That's an added bonus. I always use the equipment myself, not as a way to call out or antagonize, but as a way to measure levels of energy, gravitational fluctuations. And I myself do it a bit differently. I don't necessarily call out to anything. If it makes itself known to me or it appears before me, I'm not going to be rude. I'll say, hey, how you doing? And if it doesn't respond, then obviously it's a residual. But if it responds, then it's kind of a crapshoot. Why is it responding to me? What are its intentions? And is this something that is of a negative nature, toying with my perception to possibly get me to let my guard down and move in further?
Yeah. Yep. That's very true. It happens a lot.
Good question,
it does,
Patty.
Happen, but you never know if you're being lied to.
No.
That's my mm-hmm. point. I mean, when Patrick investigated this place, one of his questions was, what is your purpose here? And the answer he got was, put fear. Well, unfortunately, at the time, it was working.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, that could have been the spirit of the child that we also know is here, who was just trying to be bigger than she was. I don't know. You know, it's...
I've heard of that happening, yeah.
It's tough.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not Catholic, but I do... I have worked with a lot of priests in regards to investigations, and I do subscribe to the concept of purgatory. And I'm very much a subscriber to spirits being in limbo. If for some reason, say, when the person was alive, they were in great despair or suffered from depression and took their own life. My grandfather, for example, this is how the whole thing started with me. When I was 3, he committed suicide. And from that point on, I kept seeing him every year around the time that he took his own life. And it wasn't until I was about 12 that I prayed the Lord's Prayer for him and prayed for God to move him on to wherever he needs to be to find peace. And the sightings with him stopped. And I started to connect the dots, thinking possibly he was either a spirit in limbo or the property that he once owned as a living being was his purgatory. And I was the beacon he needed to cross over. I like to think that maybe I helped him find his safe passage to the Lord.
Wow. You know, we got a question in the chat room right now. It's from Moogie Lips. She wants to know, have you ever taken something home? Have you ever had an attachment?
Oh, yeah, I have. When I went to Point Pleasant the first time, spent the weekend to do an investigation there, which is where the Mothman Festival takes place, I know for a fact something came back with me, because my son, from the moment I got home and relieved my parents of their watching Lucas duty, because my wife and her mother were out of town, because they decided to take off and go somewhere for the weekend too, I noticed that he was reacting to something and interacting with something from the moment I got home. And I put him down for a nap, and he kept talking to something, pointing at it in the corner, I noticed through the baby monitor, and I went up and observed him, sat in the rocking chair. He wasn't even paying attention to me. He kept talking to whatever was in the corner. And I laid him back down and said, "You need to take your nap now. This is nap time." And the entire time I'm standing in there talking to him, I knew I was being watched. I knew I was being observed, but it didn't feel threatening. So I left the room. 10 minutes later, he starts standing up out of his crib again, talking to and pointing at and reacting to whatever was in his room. After about the third or fourth time, I went in and said, "I don't know what your intention is. I don't know why you're here. But in the name of Jesus Christ, I want you to either cross over and go to where you need to be, or go back to Point Pleasant where you came from." And within a matter of seconds, the entire feeling just left me. It just felt, I felt at ease. It felt like a great swelling of peace. And Lucas took his nap. Nothing bothered him again. Nothing talked to him again. But like I said from the beginning, it didn't feel threatening. But I also didn't want something that was foreign hanging out in my house.
Right. And that's a very serious subject. We've all had attachments. Lee brought an attachment home once called Patty, Jersey P. And she's been attached to him ever since. She's like the sore on a butt cheek. But she's...
That's more of a contractual agreement. It's more of a contractual attachment. That happens through a court of law, unfortunately. I have the same attachment. She's been with me for 15 years, and we act like a married couple that's been together for 50.
No, I'm just joking, Jersey. I don't want you to gut me at the end of the show. All right? Oh, come on now. She says she won't wait till the end. You got to give me a break. Come on now. Yeah, but that is a serious subject. All right, real quick, let's go to the shirts for the quiet ones, okay?
Oh.
I'm going to share the number. Neil's going to be giving the question and the number to call in. So if you're listening, or if you're in the chat room, if you're listening, or if you're just on the internet and you're listening, dial 513-318-PARA. That's 513-318-7272. And Neil will be giving the question for the next shirt.
In the meantime.
Yeah.
I have, Neil, have you brought home something every Mothman Festival by chance?
No, only that one time.
No. Do you feel that one time was enough for nothing to attach to you the next time you showed up?
Yeah, I make it a point now, during that time, I did not enter the town the way I usually enter a property. I just kind of drove in, devil may care, did my thing, wasn't really worried about an attachment, but every time I go into a location, even before that, and definitely after that, I always pray before and after entering and exiting as to not have anything attached to me. And much like Native American culture will teach you, when you enter a teepee, you walk in face forward, and you walk from the right to the left, counterclockwise, and upon exiting, you exit facing where you entered initially. You don't show your back upon exiting. You always face forward. So that's how I do it ritualistically when I enter a property. I walk in, always start from the right, work my way around, end to the left of the doorway, and back out of the doorway facing as I leave.
Wow, you know, it's funny you bring that up because we had a conversation with a guest that was probably about a month or two ago, and she was telling us the same thing, the same approach with a negative energy. Basically, when you're leaving the home, to always face the energy.
Yeah.
As you're backing out. If you feel that something's getting ready to attack you or it's going to follow you home, face the energy, then back out. And I don't remember how that whole conversation came up, but it was an interesting conversation. We brought it up before again, but it's kind of weird that you said that. So do you do any other type of, besides prayer, do you do any type of cleansing?
Yeah, I always travel with holy water. Seriously, I always travel with holy water. And I don't really do blessings anymore. A couple of occasions before having children, I was doing some blessings in a house and blessings over a newborn child. And due to things happening in the house upon them bringing the child to the home, and it resulted in a negative effect, a very angry, vengeful, negative entity was a result of it, and I ended up having to get the church involved, which did not set well with me because I felt responsible for it. And fortunately, they were able to eradicate whatever the issue was, but I've made it a point to not dabble in that anymore as to not cause any disturbance.
Okay. I want to jump real quick back to one of your books.
Mm-hmm.
In Haunted Chillicothe, if a paranormal investigator is reading this book, would there be actually good enough resource for a paranormal investigator to go to one of these locations? Or does the book just mainly involve for the public, the general public, or can a paranormal investigator read this book and get some information on how to get into this location and investigate it?
Yeah, I make a point to have a good general idea of where the location is for the reader to know where they're going, or if they want to go, how to get there.
Okay, nice. Now, which is, like, out of all the locations in Chillicothe, if Paravisions was to come up that way, which is one you would recommend to us?
The Majestic Theater.
Oh, mm-hmm. I've heard about that. Yes.
They stored a lot of soldiers, didn't they, there before? They call it Blood Alley or something like that?
Yeah, the morgue was way over-occupied, and they actually started stockpiling bodies on the stage, beneath the stage, in the basement, in the dressing rooms, and when they ran out of room there, they took to private residences and actually went into people's homes and paid them to hold bodies in their basements and cellars until they could continue draining out the blood and embalm these soldiers, because they were all dying at such a rapid pace from the Spanish flu. And what's funny is this entire area, Chillicothe, this whole region, is known as Ground Zero for the outbreak, because it all started at Camp Sherman. And as they came in and set up there and then moved on to their different squadrons throughout Ohio, Kentucky, West Virginia, down to Tennessee, it just flooded the valley region, the Appalachian Mountains. It just, everybody was dropping dead from it. And Chillicothe is known as Ground Zero as a result of that. And we lost a lot of people, hundreds of thousands throughout the, we don't have hundreds of thousands of people in Chillicothe, but hundreds of thousands of people throughout the tri-state region, through the Appalachian Mountains, down to Georgia, Alabama, all died from this.
Wow, that's crazy. I never knew that.
Mm-hmm.
Never knew that.
It's the last great pandemic we had in the United States.
God.
You know, I knew a little bit about the story, but I didn't. Now, where is... Now, are you close to that theater? Is the theater still... I mean, what is the theater today?
It's still standing. It's still used as a theater, but it's more of a music hall now. They don't really show movies there anymore. and they have a lot of bands come in, a lot of musicians come in, comedy acts. It's not open every day. It's not open every weekend. They just have special venues that they operate from there now.
Gotcha. Now, how about, have they had any experience, I mean, any activity going on in there now? Have they reached out to you, you know, cleaning, you know, as they're cleaning, or people sitting there watching a concert or something like that?
I have people talk to me about the Majestic almost every week, and we did an investigation overnight stay in 2009 at that theater, and it's the most active spot I've ever spent the night in. And not active as in a bad way, but active as in something is going on. There's more than one spiritual energy there. Whether it's male or female, it's anyone's game, anyone's guess. I felt very at ease while staying there, very just enthralled with the entire experience.
Is this place open to the general public?
On certain occasions, yes. If you're wanting to do an investigation, they're very, very picky and particular about it. I was lucky because I know almost everyone on the board of directors. Plus, I'm a very good friend with our local historian here, and he got me in.
So, Neil Parks says Paravisions can go with him. Paravisions can investigate the Majestic Theater.
I might be able to make that happen.
You're starting to become my friend, Neil.
Now,
just now?
Neil, Neil, you know, the question that I wanted to ask, when you guys were, during your investigation in there, and you said it wasn't nothing bad, it was, you just felt like there was more than one, did you feel like they were reaching out for you, like help, you know, some of them probably weren't dead? Maybe they took some of those in there for, you know, to get them out of the way. Did you feel any of that when you guys were walking around the building? Because I remember when you told me about the investigation, because you showed me some pictures as you was walking up on one of the levels when we were at that Ohio Paracon.
Mm-hmm.
You shared some pictures and was sharing a little bit, but I didn't get to ask you the atmosphere. How was that? I mean, you know, you can tell when you're, like you said, when you was in your child's room and you felt like you're being watched, but you wasn't threatened. You know, and it's like sometimes when we investigate, you can feel if something is mad behind you. I don't want to say demonic because I've never experienced anything demonic. And, you know, and everybody wants to assume that everything is demonic. And like you told the one in your, you know, in the room of your child's room, you know, you said the magic word, you know. Lord, you know, if he's there, nothing's there. And, you know, I'm always thinking of Jesus Christ the entire time we're investigating. And sometimes I don't feel things. Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to know how you felt at the time investigating that theater. Did you feel like they knew you were someone good that believed in God and maybe they were reaching out for your help or a simple prayer or, you know, they wanted to share a message?
I felt that on several areas of the property. When we were in the basement area near the dressing rooms, there's a door that is now sealed off, but it at one time led to an underground tunnel that went to the hotel that used to be next to the theater that has since burned to the ground. But that tunnel access is vital because a little girl died from smoke inhalation trying to get through to get away from the hotel the first time it burned, before it burned completely to the ground. The last time it burned completely to the ground, it was vacant and had not been used in decades, and lightning struck it and it caught on fire. So that building is long gone, but that doorway really struck me because the minute I touched it, I felt like someone was on the other side begging for my help, begging to talk to me. And I was kind of taken aback from that because I'm thinking, well, is this thing that's wanting to talk to me, are its intentions pure? And I just studied the room a bit more, and I got close to the dressing room, and I remember people telling me that when they're in that dressing room, they'll look around the corner of the doorway and see a little girl peeking in at them. And as I'm thinking that, I'm looking in one of the mirrors of the dressing room, And one of my members of the research team says, "Oh my God, look at that." And I'm looking in the mirror and I see a little girl peeking around the corner at us, staring in the room at us. And my friend from my team is white as a t-shirt. And he's standing there shaking and he's not filming it. He's not getting any readings. And I'm like, "Dude, take the camera out. Take the camera out. Try to get something." And she's watching us the whole time. I turn and look, and she's not in the doorway, but I look in the mirror, and she's standing there. And I look
what?
At... Yeah, I look at her as she's still standing there in the mirror reflection. I said, "You don't have to be afraid. You can just walk in here." And she moved away from the doorway and just kind of walked in and vanished. And I'm looking at my friend, and I'm like, "Are you okay to film?" And he's like, I don't know. I don't know." It's the first time we ever had a breakdown like that. And I'm like, "Well, I don't feel threatened by this girl. I would suggest you start filming, start taking some random photographs." And he's like, "Okay." And he starts fumbling around with the camera, and he's just hitting it at random, just taking shots, but the lid is still on the lens. And I pop it off with my thumb. I'm like, "For God's sake, just take some pictures." And I'm walking around.
Yeah.
I'm walking around where she's had disappeared at first, and I sit down in a chair next to that area, and I'm looking around, and I'm like, "You've been down here a long time, haven't you?" And he's looking at me, he's like, "Dude, you're talking to her? Why are you talking to her? She might scratch us." And I'm like, "That's not gonna happen. That's not gonna, I don't feel like she's gonna scratch me or do anything. She's just curious about us, because we are down here not yelling at her, saying, 'Show yourself,' not saying, 'Go ahead, push me,' none of that crap." And it was a real feeling of peace, almost like she came in and sat down on the floor and just watched us, so like it was story hour for her or something. And the next dressing room, one of my fellow members took a picture of the mirror because she thought it was a beautiful mirror. It was an antique fixture, antique angles around it, the way it was set up. And when she took a picture of the mirror, in the reflection is a very tall man hovering above her and a white button-down shirt, and the outline of his face is all black. Full form showing there, but his hands and his face are all black, and I'm wondering if maybe he died in the fire. And that's what we're seeing, is a residual imprint of his burned body. But, I mean, the shirt was super white, button-down. I'm thinking, well, why would his entire body be burned but his shirt not? Is that some sort of a lure for us to start provoking it, asking it questions? I told her just to keep the picture and just leave it at that. I said, "The picture is good enough for me. We don't need to press any further on this, because it just seems weird that there'd be a burned body with a really nice white shirt on." I don't know, maybe I was overthinking it.
Do you remember, this is from Jim Wilson, do you remember what type of camera was being used for that picture?
Kodak 5-megapixel Easy Share.
Okay. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. You know, that's the questions, Neil, that you always, well, I know I always ponder about. When we get these pictures of apparitions and are not fully formed, like, for instance, his face is all black. We can look at that several different ways. Is it all black because the manifestation can't take its full form? Or is it all black because of what you just said about being burnt, you know, and the arms being missing? Or is it that way because of just numerous things, you know? And it's one of the things that I always ponder about when we get these apparitions and pictures that aren't full body.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I get that feeling a lot about some of the things I've seen, wondering if it's an illusion, wondering if it's me projecting something through my own mind because I want so desperately to see something, or what you just said earlier.
Right. It's something I think about all the time, you know. I've been lucky to actually capture something that I actually would call a full body.
Yeah.
You see arms, legs, face, everything there. But it's the questions. It's something that it's just another mystery. We always, mm-hmm. It's just something to add to paranormal, you know, we'll never really know.
You you know, Neil, this is Lee. You know, going back to, you know, where you was, you felt like that little girl wanted to communicate, you know, there's been times when we go out and do investigations. There's been times where, you know, I'll leave the investigation and on my way home or the next day or the week down, you know, as I'm running through my audio, I feel like I didn't give the spirit enough of my time. I didn't answer the questions that they needed answered. You know, we're there, you know, I tell our clients that we're not just there for them. I'm not just going to get you your answers because there is a reason they're here. So let us get to know the spirit and figure out what's going on. And then I can get your answers and then we'll all be happy. And, you know, sometimes they look at you like, well, they didn't call you in. I did. But
yeah,
you got to on this, that page, you know, that we don't want to stir up any bad negative energy. And we want to get to know them. And, you know, we do tell them. You know, they'll be telling us something that they saw, our client. But we got to turn it. We got to pitch a curveball to our spirit that we're trying to communicate with. And I'll tell them, like, hey, what I'm about to say may make you mad. But I'm going to ask the spirit a different way than what you're trying to tell me. You know, and sometimes we'll get answers. But the point is that I'm trying to get is I feel like I didn't give enough, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't go up there and I didn't. And I feel like there's a lost soul there that almost had my full attention, but I didn't give it to him. Or I didn't spend enough time in that one bedroom. Because that child that's in there was, you know, just scoping us out. And we got up and said, we don't feel nothing in here. So we left. But that child is scared to come into the rest of the home because there may be somebody there that scares that child. You know, there's so many factors that we take in play when we're doing paranormal investigating that sometimes it brings tears to my eyes because I feel like there are so many lost souls. You know, like these people that die, they don't even know they're dead.
Yeah. I've dealt with a few of those. It's very depressing.
Is depressing, you know, and like the Dayton Air Show last year, the lady that was on top of the plane, you know, she was waving to the crowd. She did not know that she was getting ready to die.
No.
And you know, she's still, and I hope that she found, you know, the white light and she did go to it. But, you know, there's so many people out there that are lost and they're not there to scare the family. They're just there because the energy is great. You know, it's a positive home. The energy is good. That's where they're going to stick around. But they're confused. They're lost. And that's why, you know, we got to open up. Even if it's a textbook that has nothing on it, we got to write a chapter. Because the paranormal is all about learning.
Yeah, the movie series Insidious paints an elaborate picture on the dead not really knowing that they're dead.
Yeah, absolutely. A perfect movie.
Yeah. Have you seen the second one?
The others. Second one is good.
Oh, the others is a good example.
Yeah.
Or Bruce Willis and The Sixth Sense. Bruce Willis had no idea he was dead.
Yeah.
Neither did we until the end.
That was. Surprise!
Yeah.
You know, this is going back farther. There was a movie, I can't remember, John Travolta played in it. He didn't know he was dead. He was an angel. It was really good, you know, and it was something, too, that he started to notice. Michael, great.
Wow, you're good,
man.
Patty.
That, let me tell you, that is a great movie. I recommend, guys, if you guys want to go, this is just two words, old school. Pick up some of these old movies that we're talking about. Sixth Sense, a phenomenal movie. You know, Michael, that's a great movie.
Poltergeist.
What's the other one?
Poltergeist.
There you go. You know, I bought that for $4 still. Me and Pat, we went one night, we were looking for scary movies, and oh my God, we were just blown away with all the scary movies. You know, we also found, like, I got The Jerk for $4.
That's a great
Blazing film. Saddles for $4.
Blazing Saddles.
That is, oh, buddy.
We got a $4 Blazing Saddle special on aisle 7.
Yes, that is fantastic.
Yeah, that would be the
no, but I'm trying to think of the movie where it's a, they're in the they're out like it's set the setting's like the Signs, the old farmhouse, but they're pitching ball.
Yes,
baseball. The team comes out of the field.
Oh,
yeah, Field of Dreams.
Field of Dreams.
Yes.
Yeah, that's great. You know, it's just if you don't believe in something other than us living, you gotta wake up, people, because there's too many signs out there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, pick up your Bible. If you don't want to watch a movie, pick up your Bible. There's so many. You know, I watched something really cool the other night on Easter Sunday. Who is Jesus Christ? Me and Patty watched that for a couple hours. That, mm-hmm. It was on the History Channel.
Yeah.
Of all of the information that guy is so real of who is Jesus. I mean, they going back, you know, talking to archaeologists in Jerusalem, Galilee, you know,
yeah,
where he's from. Seeing some of the, what they dug up, some of the floors that was in some of those mansions, they show. They're walking through. This is live. I mean, they were showing it like they videoed this, like a documentary. And they put a face of what Jesus really looked like. And you know what? And we all think of him what it is. And it's close enough. You know, he has the beard. But, you know, me and Patty looked at each other and she said something that really, the guy that played Jesus, looked like a prick. Didn't he? He did.
He looked really arrogant. And so I was disappointed, especially being kind of a learner, you know. He looked like Billy Zane, actually.
Yeah.
But he did. He looked very conceited. And all these people are flocking around him. And he's looking down on them. Remember, he's riding that mule into the town or whatever. And he's just looking down on them with this smirk on his face. I just wanted to punch him. But I know, you know, he wasn't supposed to be looking that way. He was supposed to be all pious and gentle. He just looked like a douche.
You can hear him using Stewie's voice from from the Family Guy going, "Oh, really, Brian? I am the Lord and Savior. I'm Jesus."
Oh, man, that was good, man.
That was great.
But, you know...
Do that again!
Yeah, we got requests. Can you do that one more time, Neil? One more time.
"Oh, really, Brian? I'm the Lord and Savior. I am your Christ." You can hear him saying that.
That's good, man. And that nailed this guy playing this part, you know, and to get somebody to play, you know, like if I was an actor. And
I'm going to break bread and give you 5,000 fish now. Shut up.
You know, can you imagine that actor being told that, "Oh, you're playing Jesus." Really? The Almighty? You're picking me to play the Almighty? You know, Mel Gibson. I mean, come on, you know, think of all these people that's played the Almighty.
Maybe the guy was an atheist.
That could have been. Yeah. He just did it for a gig. He just wanted the paycheck, so he'd go home.
He's like, "I can finally buy a sandwich."
Sandwich. Oh, man. But, you know, as we're talking about this, you know, and it is Easter weekend and in the resurrection, you know, it's big, you know, I feel it. It's still strong. It's growing. You know, to be a young child, 10, 11 years old, when your mother came to you and said, "You're the Son of God." Could you imagine? Because in this documentary, and it was they're putting all the stuff that is real today, where you can see that God was real. Jesus is real. He looked at her like Jesus was looking at Mary like, "Woman, you lost your mind."
You know, nobody got time for
that. That's the face that he was given.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
Exactly.
You love Jesus. I'll stop. I'm sorry.
No, I'm just making sure that I'm not sitting in your house, Neil, by you. But if you do get struck by lightning, it will probably come through the waves and to my computer, this microphone.
Neil, you still with us?
But, you know,
yeah.
To get to be told that every day of your childhood life, that you're the Son of God. And then not being the typical kid like Jesus was. You know, Jesus didn't hang out with the kids. Kids wanted to beat him up, didn't they, babe? They were chasing him. They wanted to beat him up in every village he went to.
Especially if you look like that guy.
She said, especially if you look like... You know, and then he would sit down with all of these preachers, and he would want to study, and he would want to learn everything he could. You know, he was the smartest kid ever in that area. You know, and it just, you know, I don't know. I almost stopped because I can go and go and go because I've been really focused on him and resurrection.
Oh, I did have a question in the chat room.
But we
oh,
have a question.
Gosh.
Yes, we do have a question in the chat room. Another one. And this question is from our winner of the wonderful T-shirt, Chris.
Yay.
He asked earlier about the Echovox, if you use the Echovox, or if you've ever heard of it.
That's like the ghost box, right?
Yeah, it's kind of like that, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's an app for your phone, which takes the environmental sounds, and it has a loop on it.
Phone
and
apps.
And it causes an echo.
When it comes to phone apps, I stick with Skylanders and Angry Birds. I don't really trust any kind of investigative app design. It to me, it's just not foolproof.
Yeah, this I will. That's you have a very good opinion. That's a very good opinion. I've tried it myself. It's a very good app. Out of all the apps out there that are made for investigating, I've gotten some really good answers. One of the questions was from the Dayton Victoria Theater, which we investigate every now and then. And one of the questions was what was the name of the lady who was murdered from that performed here? Was an actress, and she was murdered. And clear enough, after all the echoing, you hear just as plain as could be, you know, you hear a lady say, Vicky. And that's what really turned me on to it. I, you know, I was like, wow, I finally got an answer. And it's an answer we've been waiting for through our EVPs.
Hmm. Okay, now you've piqued my interest.
It's worth giving a try. Now, the app is a little costly, though. It's no dollar app. If I remember right, it's about $20.
God!
I could...
What?
Yeah.
$20?
Bill, you know what that means? Yeah, you're going to have to take away one of your lunches for the week.
Gosh.
Come on, you could sell a book. I said a butt. A butt.
You could sell a butt.
You could sell a book and get the money for that app.
Yeah, I could.
Or a couple apps.
He said I could, but...
But I have too many comic books and action figures to purchase, you know?
So now what are...
Oh, gosh.
Lunchbox? You made a post about a lunchbox. You were interested in it until you opened it up.
Yeah, a mummified sandwich was inside.
You opened the can of worms.
It was a mummified sandwich inside from the 80s. The old lady...
Are you serious?
Yes.
One of the old metal lunchboxes, because Patty has the Happy Days one.
No way. Yeah, it just shows how old you really are.
Wow.
That's days.
These happy days are...
So what was the lunchbox, Neil?
It was the Muppet Show from 1985.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm.
And it was probably a sandwich from 1985 when the kid goes, I don't want this.
Yeah, the older lady that owned it, it was in a box, and she had 5 marked on it. She says, oh, I don't know. They just took that out of the attic. I'm like, oh, really? It's in great condition. I pop it open. I'm like, oh. It smelled worse than a non-embalmed cadaver. It was all bloated and swollen. And there were a couple of flies landed on it and died. So I threw the lunchbox down. Like, forget this.
Now just think, you know, that could have been a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Now, if peanut butter today was in schools, kids would break out. They would swell up. You know, back then when we were little eating peanut butter, you know what? I was just talking about that today, you know, about how allergies of peanut butter are not allowed. You know, that's not allowed in schools. You got to know.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. You can't take peanut butter or peanuts in school.
It's all the synthetic hormones they're injecting our food with.
It's scary, you know, it's like, you know, I was just telling him, Neil, before you called. We used to gnaw on our bed, our crib as grown up, we had lead paint on them, you know?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there was a video out called We Survive. It's on YouTube. We
Son,
Survive.
You might have gnawed on your bed, but I didn't. I don't know what kind of freak show you are, but let me tell you, I mean, I've never gnawed on my little bedpost.
Did you ever lick the window?
Probably because you were tied to it.
Oh, God!
What do you mean? He didn't have a bed post. They just put his mattress on the floor and said, go to sleep, kid. Shut up.
Hold your Pepsi can. Hey. We can't afford a teddy bear. Hold your Pepsi can.
Because let me tell you, when I was in my big bed, this is no joke, I had the big, tall Barbie G.I. Joes.
Big, tall bars.
The Barbie G.I. Joes, you know. I remember one guy, I can't remember his name right off the top of my head, but he the hair on the Barbies were real. Like, the beards were real, like the hair.
Guys.
No, it was the black guy. He had a jumpsuit on and,
Mr. T!
No, it was part of G.I. Joe. But I wished I had those. And, Neil, I thought of you the other day when I was talking to my cousin. He brought something up to me that he goes, Lee, you collected Star Wars figurines. I said, yes, I did. And he goes, do you remember the Darth Vader mask that you opened up?
Yes, you put the figures in.
I had that.
Yeah.
And I don't have
you
it.
You just
today.
Became my best friend. Oh, Neil Parks.
Insidious.
Yes.
Neil, do you know that we think of you when we watch Insidious, Neil?
Because of Specs.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
I want to kill that guy. He obviously stole my image. He straight up stole my image. He has my mannerisms. He uses his hands the same way when he speaks. It's just too similar.
Hey, we're watching it the first time, and I'm like, I looked over at Patty, and I'm like, you know what? That guy looks familiar. And she goes, yeah, I know. And we're watching. I go, Neil Parks. She rolls, man.
I was rolling, man. I was dying. I was off the couch, Neil. I'm sorry.
Think of this, man. Watch that again. He had the glasses with the lights on his. He
yes.
already had the Parahunter.
Oh, yeah.
The glasses.
Yeah,
the
illuminators. He had the illuminators on his
had
glasses.
He had those before they even was big.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow, buddy. Before his time.
Have you, do you know about those, Neil? The full spectrum video glasses, HD?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't have a pair, but yeah.
Well, it's just too bad.
Yeah.
Maybe you should sell some more books. Maybe you can afford one.
Maybe I should.
This guy, I'm just joking, man. I'm just joking. Don't come over here and kill me, all right?
Maybe I could stop writing crap and start selling real books.
This guy.
No, but hey, Neil, do you still have that sandwich you can throw in this car?
I could do that. It would make the paint peel off.
No, going back to that, do you go to, do you do a lot of eBay shopping for stuff like that?
I certainly do. Not for dirty sandwiches, but for nostalgic items, yes.
Exactly. Do you, I heard you say that you actually was you picking? Do you go out and pick?
Yeah, I do. I've been picking long before the show ever came out.
Well, we need to go do that. You need to come our way, and we'll go out and do some of that.
We'll have to meet in the middle somehow.
Yeah.
Because you live too far, and I live too far from you.
Like, so far. 2 hours.
God. I have to stop every 40 minutes just to stretch, or I get tired.
I know. Patty just says, this is coming from the guy that's referring his cases that's like 2 minutes from his house. You know what? We're here to help everybody. You know, that's the thing. We got to help them, you know. And
it was just down the street.
Lady. I can't wait and to help her. And I'll keep you posted on that, how that turns out.
Heck yeah. Hey, Neil, what was the greatest find you had on one of your pickings?
It was an Elvis board game that was commemorating the 10th year anniversary of his death. There were only 500 made exclusively for Kenworth CEOs and employees. It was some sort of because the casing was fiberglass, and it said Elvis, and it was spelled out E-L-V-I-S. That was the entire casing, all white fiberglass, made by the same material that's used on the dashes and the instrument panels of semi-trucks made by Kenworth. So they had a special commemorative box made just for that. Only 500 made. Dude's wife sells it at the yard sale for $5. It's worth about
$3,500. Oh, wow. Do you still have this?
I do.
Wow. And you know, I mean, it all comes down to the person who goes out looking knows the value of things. Knows the value, and or he knows what he's looking for.
Yeah, you got to know what you got to know all that. The research has to be there.
Yeah.
I mean, because I wouldn't know, you know, but I would be fascinated to stuff that caught my eye. You know, not just things that I grew up on, but I'm into, like, you know, when I watch American Pickers, I'm into the old lights that you see hanging on buildings. Yeah. I'm into those. There's a lot of old things that I would love to have, you know, because I like to. You know, Jim, that's stuff that I like to put back together and watch it work.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I'm with you.
For like yourself, you already have a goal. Do you already have an idea of what you're looking for, or are you going out with no expectations of what you're looking for?
I always go out with no expectations, and that way I don't set the bar too high. That way I'm not disappointed if it doesn't turn out the way I want it. I peruse Craigslist and the local newspaper for yard sales and odds and ends that are being sold, or even getting on Craigslist and looking for free items. You wouldn't believe what people throw away just to get out of their house. And then I'll turn around and clean it up and tweak it a bit and make a profit on it. That's a hobby of mine. Has been for years.
You know, there is a Middletown Antiques right here. I was actually there last year doing an inspection. Excuse me. And she was cleaning up a lot of furniture, and she had this big armoire. Beautiful. Had a big mirror on it, you know. Mm-hmm. And she goes, all of this stuff was, people wanted to have it removed, so they called us up. We send out my sons. We pick it up. We bring it in. They look it up. She was showing me names underneath, you know, where they snap pictures. This armoire, you know, was free to her. All it cost her was gas and to pay her son to go get it, you know.
Yeah.
$30. Dude, this thing's probably worth $10,000.
Jesus.
You know, it's got the marble top, like where it's like three drawers and a marble top, then the mirror, then on the side you can open it up and you can hang your shirts.
Oh my God.
Beautiful. And I'm like,
I'll take 40.
Next time you get something for free, I will go pick it up.
Yeah. It might not make it back.
It may not make it back, but something will. Maybe a sandwich in it.
There's a sandwich. Sandwich with my name on it.
So, do you go out looking by yourself, or do you take your wife? Do you take your kids?
I can't get my wife to go to a flea market or a yard sale. She's too high maintenance. I do take my son with me. He loves what I love collecting anyway. He's really into science fiction and fantasy and superheroes. A kid after my own heart. And I always take him out with me during the National Free Comic Book Day, which is always the first Saturday in May, which this year will be May 3rd. And we always go to a comic shop and get free comics. They have like five or six that you can choose from. And I choose one of each, or two of each, actually. One for me, one for him. Well, five for me, five for him, technically. And then I always end up buying something in the comic shop anyway. I'm sorry.
There's one for you, kid, and for me.
One for you, ten for me.
One for you, one.
That's how you do math, son.
Now, oh, yeah.
Now, Neil, are you teaching him, you know, the responsibility of taking care of these things? I mean, since he is going out with you, mm-hmm. and to understand the value and the history behind things that you pick, and
he always, you know, asks to borrow some of my comic sleeves so he can put his comics in there to keep them from getting bent.
That's nice. Yeah. That's good, though. That he is learning.
That's a value saver right there.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when he gets older, you know, he's not just going to take dad's in. He's got his, too.
Yeah.
And, you know, have you ever been to the Cincinnati Comic-Con convention?
No, but I saw an advertisement for it, and one of my favorite actresses who was in the show Firefly as the mechanic, she's going to be there.
Are you serious, dude?
Yeah, the little cutesy that was the mechanic in Firefly, she's gonna be there.
Oh my god, dude, I cannot believe this. I'm sweating right now. My palms are sweaty. My chest hair is rising on its ends right now. This is just unbelievable.
She is a doll.
You know what? We are going to be there again this year. We were there last year. We had a table there. And we're going to be there again this year. Last year, we really great guest. And I was looking for you because I figured, hey, we can find you roaming around in a crowd. Yeah.
Maybe this year, since she's going to be there. And you will, too. I'll bring you a sandwich.
I'll spit it in your face, son.
The only thing that would be better if Summer Glau were going to be there, too.
Oh, my God. I don't know.
You don't know Summer Glau?
She would just be, like, on the $5 table that I would pass up, and you'd be all over. I mean, seriously, if you don't know.
You don't know Summer Glau? She played in Firefly. No. She was the sister. She was the weapon.
I don't even know what Firefly is.
You don't know Firefly?
She was the sister. Yeah, you're right. She was the one that had all the skills that
the
they
special
didn't
ability.
Know about. And then all of a sudden, you know, it comes out.
She also played
I never knew about Firefly until about 6-7 years ago. My friend had it all, like all the seasons on DVD. Mm-hmm. This is before Blu-ray. And
Wait, there were seasons on Firefly? Yeah, because Jim, you know, my question, I wanted you to get this. So is this like the time X-Files was on? Or are we talking that time?
No, it's not that far back.
No, it was after X-Files.
You know what? What made this show so unique and so cool to me was the fact that it takes space and cowboys and puts it all together. Mm-hmm. And that's what I thought was so trippy. I thought it made it so unique. So cool, because these guys are wearing, like, they got pistols, and they got their style that they wear is, it's in, like, a cowboy format.
Okay, but you know what the equivalent of that would be to me is
Space Cowboys.
Yeah, well, no, so the movie up with,
Spaceballs.
No!
Cowboys and Aliens.
Thank you! Cowboys and Aliens. Thank you.
Jim, you didn't like none of
my
answers.
Oh, my God.
I'm giving you some good shows.
Sounds like I'm an idiot for 200, Jack. Yeah, it's up there. I'm on it. I'm all over it.
No, but seriously, me and Jim has never heard of Firefly.
See, wait. Hey, Neil, remember, I'm the guy that has dial-up, so I am also the guy that doesn't have cable either.
Are you Mormon or something? Or Mennonite?
That's probably why I can't find a date, but that's another story.
So you got some things to talk about at the dinner table? Have you watched Firefly?
No.
Well, then this date is over.
I think I'm looking for the date. Have you seen Firefly? Nope. We're getting married.
There's a new show that started this Sunday night. We wanted to watch it, and we didn't watch it. And the name's slipping my mind.
Salem.
On WGN.
Oh,
Salem.
Yes.
Salem. Oh, we DVR'd it. Now,
oh,
Neil,
nice.
Have you watched it?
Yeah, it's terrific.
Oh, good. I'm so glad for Jersey P.
Another one is coming there, and that's the vampire show From Dusk Till Dawn is now a series, and it looks bad. The chicks are hot. The show is awesome. It looks great.
You know why I don't watch those shows? Because I ain't got a shot at getting any of them.
But, Jim, we can get cool ideas for
the show's not about the chicks. It's about vampires, like, biting people and ripping heads off and pooping down their necks.
Okay, so one out of three ain't bad.
All right, what is this?
Are they pooping half-eaten sandwiches?
Half-eaten sandwich.
What's this business Chris is putting in the chat room that next Thursday is Star Wars Day? What is this?
May the fourth be with
you. Is that in Florida? Is it in Florida? No,
it's
no,
nationwide.
It's
nationwide. It's all over the globe. May the fourth be with you. And the fifth is always Revenge of the Fifth.
Okay.
Well, that is not Thursday, Chris.
That's Saturday. That's Sunday.
Because I've been to Florida when it's going down.
Thursday's May 1st.
When the
Chris.
Big thing is going down at, I believe it's what, MGM? No, I mean Hollywood Studios.
Yeah.
And it places insane.
It is crazy.
Star Wars junkies all over the place.
So, Neil, here's what I want you to do. I'm going to be your client. I want you to find me a Darth Vader mask. One that really changes my voice. Because I may need this for September. I'm DJing a wedding, buddy. Listen to this. This is all around Star Wars. Their theme for their wedding is Star Wars.
Oh, that is nice.
You need a Chewbacca mask, man. I need a Princess Leia scooter. Would you like to be in her?
You know what? Kiss my ass.
I don't think the tutu would fit right.
Jim, you want to be Yoda?
You know, he's C-3PO. You know, he's all skinny. And
he is C-3PO.
He even stands like C-3PO sometimes. He puts his arms up on his sides. Yeah, oh my god, Jim, you are C-3PO, dude.
Oh, all too.
Oh, that's perfect, Jim. That's you.
Oh, you know what? I'll be at Church of St. Happening, so thanks for asking.
Jim, let's just spray paint you gold, okay?
R2, where are you?
And that little walkie does.
Oh my god, I don't know where I'm at.
It's the most homoerotic relationship in science fiction, man.
Oh my god.
You know what, though? Thank god that we have that kind of stuff, that we grew up with that. You know, oh my god, I remember when that first came on, when I first watched that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking like probably when it first came out, early
1980s. 1977 was the first Star Wars.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking like 1980 when I first watched it. You know, I'm sitting there in the living room. Mom has the big floor model TV.
Was she eating a TV dinner?
You know, why don't they have? Sit back. And you remember the little box that you could push the little things down, it would change the channels.
I had one of those.
Remember those?
Yeah.
It was connected to the cable, and you would hit it, and it would change the channels. And I remember, Mom says, Star Wars comes on tonight. So I'm like, oh. I said, can I stay up and watch the whole thing before I go to bed? I remember that, man. That was so cool. And you know what I really liked at the end? The way that all the the credits, how they went up nothing. Yeah. And I was like, I thought I was the coolest thing ever. Still afraid of the dark. But I was the coolest kid ever watching that.
Hey, Neil, what was your favorite Star Wars movie? The sequels and the prequels.
The Empire Strikes Back is by far my favorite one out of the entire series. The prequels I was okay with. The first one I thought was super lame. But I watched it and enjoyed it anyway and bought the action figures based on the movies. The second one I thought was an improvement, but they really rushed the love story between Queen Amidala and Anakin. The third one I thought was super good as far as the prequels go. It was the best of the three, where it built up to Anakin becoming Darth Vader and falling into the dark side. I thought they rushed it a bit with him all of a sudden kneeling before Emperor Palpatine once he revealed himself as the true Sith Lord. It was slightly disappointing on how he all of a sudden decided to kneel before him and then killed all of the Jedi youngling. I'm really anxious to see the new series because it's going to follow the expanded galaxy timeline, which takes place 30 years after the end of Return of the Jedi, which means all the original cast will be returning and will be featuring and focusing in on their offspring and the rise of a new empire.
That's awesome. That's just awesome. Whoa, got some echo going on.
It's recording.
Oh, it's on Neil's. Okay. What I was gonna say, Neil's, I've been doing some hardcore thinking today about you. Not in a manly way.
Not in a C-3PO way.
I started wondering, was Return of the Jedi what got you into the paranormal? Because in Return of the Jedi, if you remember, at the end, a lot of the good ones, such as Yoda, who passed away, and
Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Trying to think of his name.
Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Obi-Wan. They all come back. Remember, they're with the Ewoks having a look, and they're celebrating, and then their spirits return.
That would be one thing that kept the momentum going for me, seeing that and realizing that the realm that we are in physically, there's things surrounding us that we don't even see or not even aware of, and that's a good representation of that.
Thanks. I told you it was something manly.
Yeah, very.
Or, I mean, if people don't know, you have one hell of an extensive collection of Star Wars figures on. I mean, you could, it would take you hours to even name everything, but when did you first get interested in, and or when was your first action figure? Like, how old were you that got you decided to collect what you collect and or why you collect?
I started collecting Star Wars hardcore when I was about five or six. That's what really got me into going to yard sales, going to flea markets, because not everybody realized the nostalgic value would soon be passed up by the monetary value of those items. Star Wars has always been a very important part of, I guess, my life. Not that I base my life on it, but it just, the story itself and the cinematic value of the film just really struck a chord with me and still does to this day. And it's a part of my daily repertoire. If people I'm talking to have no interest in seeing Star Wars or in hearing about it, I normally change the topic or just move on. But if they say something like, I've never even watched the Star Wars films, that is a door opened, an opportunity waiting for someone to discover the magic of that story. Because there will come a day when all men and women will unite with a common goal, and that is to see Star Wars. Is that how we're going to end the show?
I'm good. How'd you like that?
Oh, he was going with it. Okay, yeah,
I was waiting for him to be like, there you go. I'll just start talking.
Well, we're at 9 o'clock, so let's finish the show with some Star Wars.
Here, Sulu era.
That's right. John Williams, you brought this.
Yeah.
I got my lightsaber out and I'm playing with it right now, people.
Oh boy.
Is that what you call it?
Isn't that another movie, Mini-Me?
Mini-Me.
Austin Powell. Well, Neil, we want to thank you so much for coming on the show. Plug in your websites. Plug in your whatever you want to plug in to get you out there so people can connect with you and they can get your books. They can see where you're going to be.
Yep, where are you going to be, what events, book signings, everything. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Let everyone know.
Yeah, I always try to keep you posted on things, and it has been a relatively quiet few months for me, just focusing in on other things I've got going on, both paranormally related and normally related.
Watch or see what you're doing, what's coming up for you then, right?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much.
Neil Parks at Facebook.
Thank you so much, Neil, for calling. We really appreciate it.
You're the man, Neil.
Go out with a bang.
We got to get together, buddy. We got to do an investigation together.
Yeah, we've talked about it for too long. We need to take action.
Yeah, let's do.
Totally.
We're down.
It's not our fault you're a no-show at the Emmett.
I know. You're never going to let me live that down, are you?
I didn't even think, man. It was busy and so freaking hot there. I mean, I almost forgot.
It was hot where me and Patty was, too, but beautiful.
Oh, just shut up over there. Okay. Just thanks for asking.
Me and Jim were sweating balls, and you guys are partying.
Hey, but that $10 fan helped out, I might add. Hey, we will. will get together there, Neil. It was great talking with you. I do appreciate you coming on. It's a fantastic collection for Star Wars action heroes. The movies, the shows, everything you do with it. It's awesome. So keep on collecting. And obviously, like you said, it values to the person of what he likes to collect. It's a big part of it.
Absolutely.
You've been doing it since you were five, man. Don't stop.
Neil,
stop.
Before we go, son, let the Force be with you in your picking, your books, your projects that you just shared.
Everything.
Good luck. We're true friends for you, and we're here for you. We got your back, and we just want to say good luck on everything you do.
And thanks for, you know, sending us some info to help some people out your way.
Absolutely.
I'm happy to.
Okay, guys, quit kissing ass, and let's get the show over.
All right, Neil, have a good night, buddy.
You
see you
too.
There, Neil. Have a great night.
You Bye-bye. Too. Thank you. Good night.
Projects that you just shared.
Everything.
Good luck. We're true friends for you, and we're here for you. We got your back, and we just want to say good luck on everything you do.
And thanks for, you know, sending us some info to help some people out your way.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, guys, quit kissing ass, and let's get the show over.
All right, Neil, have a good night, buddy.
See you there, Neil. Have a great night.
Bye-bye.
Peace out, brother.
All right. That was a great show. Now we're going to go out with a bang.
Yeah! That's Thursday! And psychic! And
absolutely.
Remember, always keep looking into the unknown, bastard!
Ladies and gentlemen, may the Force be with you!